Hi folks, I'm Father Joe Grimaldi, and you can call me Joe, and I'd like to welcome you to my podcast. But now, here's our host and friend, Ken Calvert.
Hi everybody, I'm Ken Calvert alongside the good Padre, Father Joe Grimaldi. The Father Joe Podcast, proudly supported by Hoot McInerney, Star Lincoln. Stress-free car shopping. That's what you get at Star Lincoln. It's their mission to be the automotive home of drivers right here in southeast Lower Michigan. Star Lincoln provides an incredible selection of new and used vehicles, exceptional car care, customer service with a cup of coffee and a smile. Trust me and Father Joe, we're both driving that new Lincoln MKC from Star Lincoln. I love, absolutely love my Lincoln MKC. Star Lincoln also keeps a pristine stock of used cars, trucks, SUVs. Why not shop online at starlincoln.com? Hoot McInerney, Star Lincoln, on 12 Mile Road, just east of Telegraph and Southfield. Oh yeah, you know it's the home of the Father Joe Grimaldi Star Treatment. Let's start with this. Unfortunately, we lost an iconic sports figure the past few days. Kobe Bryant on board helicopter with a total of 9 people on board, all perished. You get up that morning, and just hours later, you're gone. It's hard to reconcile for a lot of people. It's huge. It's worldwide. He had a gift, and now he's gone. Mm-hmm. Let me ask you something. Do people realize how quickly life can end?
I can't speak about other people, but I certainly think that most people don't take it seriously every day. So in other words, if we knew that we were going to somehow be gone this afternoon at 3 o'clock, and if we realized that, I think we would try to do the best we can in living in the best way possible. Now, I'm not saying that people aren't doing that, but they're not doing it as seriously as they could because they have no sense that anything could happen at 3 o'clock this afternoon. It's very sad what you say, because not only was he an icon, and he was a family man, and that comes across in everyone who's eulogizing him, not formally, but eulogizing him and speaking about his virtues. He was a very strong family man, to the point where I think his daughter was more than just a daughter to him. They were very, very close. And I think that they kind of learned from each other. And he brought that out a number of times in his interviews and things of this sort. I suspect he was the same way with all of his children. He had family values which were outstanding. And so if we could take away something like that and put it into our own lives, we would be remembering Kobe, but we would also be doing something good for humanity. So I think one of the things, you ask an interesting question, because I don't know what other people feel, but I think generally speaking, people do not live today as if it's the last day in their lives.
That's exactly where I'm going.
Yeah, and we should. In other words, if we really want to be followers of Jesus, if we want to be people who are trying to do the right thing, well then, our whole day, our whole week, our whole month, our whole year should be walking in the straight and narrow. But that doesn't happen usually, huh? And I don't have a right to speak about anybody else, but I don't think people take things like that seriously enough to change their ways.
The question that I have is that I don't know why I personally think, wow, he had no idea. Obviously, I'm stating the truly obvious, that he was putting his daughter on an airplane to go to a basketball tournament where he would be the coach, she would be playing. She loved to play basketball. There were so many people there. There's a beautiful photo out there of everyone learning what had occurred, taking a knee. I just thought to myself last night, and I've thought about it before, I've got to be honest with you. It's not an obsession, but when you hear about somebody tragically dying quickly, last thing on earth you thought would occupy your mind that day, that evening, and the next few days. I just realized how fragile life is. How fragile it is. And do you believe in the fact that was destiny?
I think that was...
A lot of people will say something like, God was calling him home. Why would God do something like that?
Well, in this case, we could even say that God was calling the pilot home. I mean,
you bring up a great point, and we're going to go there in just a second.
I'm just thinking, too, while you're speaking, the gentleman that gets in a car at 6:30 in the morning to go off to work has no idea that within the hour he might be gone.
Right.
He gets on the road, a tragic accident occurs, and he's gone. We don't think of those things. When we get ready to go to work, we have kind of an unwritten agenda in our minds on what's going to happen when I get there and so on and so forth. And so it can be changed immediately.
Scares me. I want to live a long life. I want to live a long life, and like so many people you see on occasion in their 90s, they lived a great life. They had a long life.
Sure.
They taught so many people so many things. And now, peacefully, they went to the other side. As opposed to tragedy.
I guess what I want to say is this.
Yes.
The person that lived to be 95 may or may not have affected the people around his or her life. The person who lives 41 years... in this case, has affected a lot of people, but not just because of his basketball prowess, okay? It's more than that. From what I'm learning, little by little, I'm no historian on Kobe Bryant, but I keep hearing informal eulogies, if you want. This man was certainly a family man, someone who had children as the focus of his life. Even the little books that he wrote, they were geared towards children. When you say that he lived 40 years and now he's gone, but look at what he's accomplished in 41 years, huh? To me, you could live an intense 41 years, or you could live a leisurely 95 years and not accomplish much. So I think it's important to see the individual, and I think you know that yourself.
Right.
And you know, you have to look at the individual and see. Yes, the death is tragic. It's something that people will remember years from now. His wife will never forget it.
That's what I wanted to ask. Go
she
ahead.
She lost her husband and her daughter. She probably will never forget it. However, with time, she's going to have to learn to move forward with life, and I'm sure this is what Kobe would want. I think certainly this is what the child would want without realizing it, so that the rest of the family would move on and do well in life. I know that sounds trite, but it's not trite. It's the reality of things.
I think that some people take on down the road, this is a new mission. They become somebody that can mentor and counsel people that have freshly gone through it. In other words, Kobe's wife, Kobe's family, they can all take some lesson from it, and possibly down the road, certainly not within the next year, but they may be able to mentor people as to how quickly things can change. And here's what I had to do, who I needed to see, and did I get down on my knees and pray to God saying, help me? Did I seek outside psychological counsel or friends? Of course, all of those. But maybe something, not now, maybe something good can come from this.
I think a lot of good can come from it by the way they live their lives. Nothing they say will change anybody's minds, but what they see will change their ways. And I think if they continue to be positive in their lives, you're not going to forget what happened. That's not what I'm saying. But by the same token, you can live your life in such a way that brings honor, really, to Kobe and the other daughter and gives a great example and teaches others. I don't think she's going to give talks around the country on how to cope with tragedy. Maybe, who knows, maybe she's a writer and she'll write a novel about it, or maybe write a true story about it. I have no idea what she's going to do. But what I'm saying is, if she leads her life in a good way, that's going to be an example for other people to follow.
He had his imperfections as well, and those are documented going back to 2003, because I'm sure at some point, some way, somehow, someone listening to the podcast will go, hey, he wasn't always faithful to his wife, don't forget about that. Well, of course, we all make mistakes. They taught us some life lessons in that one. She stayed with Kobe, his wife, and they worked it out, and he moved forward, and I think he became a better husband and a better father as a result of that. I've been around for 16 to 20 years. I was the Pistons public address announcer. I've been around these guys. They get a new pair of shoes maybe two times a game. They are taken care of unlike anything you and I will ever, ever, ever see. It's kind of hard to stay humble, but I do believe at some point he found that humility. Think about this. Kobe Bryant also won an Oscar for the animated short film called Dear Mr. Basketball, adding another trophy to his incredible collection, so it's just sad. I learned shortly after the crash that Kobe was a devout Catholic, went to Mass that morning, received communion. The priest mentioned he actually had holy water still on his forehead. You are Kobe Bryant's priest, pastor of the church, and you have to now address the family. How do you do that? Father Joe Grimaldi, to go speak to his wife and children, what would you say?
I think you know already, Ken, that each person is different. I can't say what I would say. When I see the situation, when I see what they're doing, when I see where they're at emotionally, psychologically, then you have to respond to those things. But it's going to be different for everyone, huh? Yeah, you said something that was interesting, that his wife was able to stand by him and work it out so that they could live a good life. However, we don't know what happens in their home. I mean, this is something that we can see only superficially. We do know this, that because of what he concentrated on, him concentrating on his love of children, what would you call that?
Short documentary.
A documentary. You know, he's really aiming to help children. He was a family man in his later years. Anyway, it's hard to say what you would say to an individual after they've lost someone like that. It depends on where they're at. Now, you're speaking about emotionally, psychologically, realistically, all of these things. Not everybody acts the same way or reacts the same way.
You're always involved at the very beginning of the process.
Yeah.
You're always involved at the beginning of the process. Do you cry with the family on occasion?
On occasion, yes. Yeah. That's because I'm a Mediterranean emotional person.
Yeah.
All right.
Well, so I cried at Caddyshack, the movie, so that tells you where I am. That's why I love you, because I can ask you those questions, but you're involved in the earliest stages of the healing process.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter if it's the 94-year-old or the 41-year-old.
When you're called upon to work with the family, right after something like this happens, it's amazing to see the difference in how people react. In some cases, they cry uncontrollably, and it's a matter of waiting it out. You don't want to be intrusive, and so you have to wait out that situation, which is a way of dealing with the deceased or the lack of the individual that they love. And so other people become vindictive. If this happened to me, I'm going to be a mean SOB, as they say, okay?
Yeah, yeah.
They don't say that, but that's the way they react sometimes, especially if they don't have other children. When they lose a child, it's very, very difficult for them to subside in their grief, because that's when they'll carry it on for more than a day or two or three or four. So everybody reacts so differently that it's interesting when you ask that question, you have to address the people where they're at.
You were talking about vindictive responsorial types,
yeah,
of
God,
reactions.
You're hurting me, I'm going to hurt you, God.
Oh, really? I was thinking more like, why in heck would you, of all the people, why did you do this?
Well, it's the same idea.
Okay.
You know, you're yelling at God, basically.
Yeah, you're right.
You're unhappy with
He's
doing.
Yeah.
Some lose their faith, some deepen it. It's kind of interesting.
That's another, you just gave me a topic, I mean, for a podcast.
Yeah. Some people just say, well, you know, it's like one of these things. You did this, I'm never going to go to church again. I want nothing to do with church. Others are
If you were a fair and righteous God, you would not have done this, not only to my husband, but to a 13-year-old.
And to my whole family.
How dare you?
You mentioned something before we started the podcast, which is interesting to me. Anyway, we're all talking about Kobe and his daughter.
Yeah.
What about the others who have perished in that crash?
It's something that I mention with my wife all the time. If you're iconic or celebrity, whatever, it's always like, we lost Ken Calvert along with five others when the helicopter he was riding in crashed. Well, you know, we've always said, oh yeah, you would be on the news tonight with a photo, maybe a series of photos, not necessarily I would, but possibly, and they would say, Ken was a great guy, boy, he had a nice 45-year career, so on and so forth, boy, you could count on him to do anything, you know. What about the other people? They had lives, they had families, they had things to do, things to accomplish, families to feed, families to enjoy life with, gone. But those people don't get the attention.
No, I could just picture the coach that was on board.
Yeah.
His wife saying, I lost my husband and daughter as well.
Yeah.
You know, this type of thing. Well, I don't know if that's done intentionally. I think the reason it's done, you know as well as I, Kobe Bryant is known worldwide. The others are not known worldwide.
Worldwide, you bet.
Hopefully the people will show respect when they speak about, in quotes, the others. I'm sure that most newscasters, and you're the expert in this, not I, would be conscious of that, and they would try to find out names at least.
And they have. Yeah, they are, and they've gathered as best they can the photos that they think should be shared.
Because with Kobe, you know, I mean, everybody knows him.
Sure.
Whereas that they don't know the other people. It's just as sad for them, but by the same token, it's not something that, I hate to use the word advertise, but mention in their newscasting. If they were going to be so super sensitive to that, they might say, well, Joe Kelly died last night on a helicopter crash, and Kobe Bryant was with him. Well, that's kind of a silly way of putting it.
Right.
Okay. So this is why I think they're forced into saying the person who is well known throughout the world, they have to mention his name and his daughter's name until they find out more details about the others.
Well, the newsroom and newsroom news directors, based on my experience, you got to be ready to change the lead in a second.
Sure.
And you've got to have people around you get me this, get me that, get me this. I need photos, I need B-roll, I need copy. I need the Academy Award shot. I need his last game. You've got to have
everything on tap.
The news changes that quickly. Final thing before we wrap it up. Somebody said on social media, this to me is one of those days that I will always be able to say, I remember exactly where I was when I heard the news.
I agree with you to an extent. There are people that don't follow sports, and they would not know his name. I agree with you. He's such an icon that he would be remembered the way people remember John
Worldwide,
F. Kennedy and so on.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
The Challenger, John F. Kennedy, the assassination.
Kobe comes close, but it's not the same thing.
Unfortunately, 9/11, you know, we can't forget it because of the fact that it's basically a hand stamp now, 9/11. What we did was we took the situation, and what I like about you, you do have a specific part in a situation like that.
Oh, definitely.
It must wear on you as well.
Well, you have to know when to be silent and when to speak.
Right.
I mean, when the individual is crying, let them cry. Now, once that's over with, then you can address different things. And when you address those things, it's always good to be silent for a while. Let them express what they're feeling, and then you could address that.
And for the children, very quickly, just tell them, in terms of helping to explain it, let's say a prayer together for the entire family. It's a sad topic, but I thought it was one we should talk about.
Thank you, Ken.
I'm Ken Calvert alongside Father Joe Grimaldi, and we will see you next time on the Father Joe Grimaldi Podcast.
I look forward to it. Thank you. This is Father Joe Grimaldi, and I look forward to seeing you next time on the Father Joe Podcast.
If you'd like, you can email us. It's FRJOEPODCAST@gmail.com. That's FRJOEPODCAST@gmail.com. We're also on Facebook. Simply search Father Joe Grimaldi. And thanks for listening, everyone.